Father Owoeye, as far as he's concerned, human beings are just the focus of pastoral work.
He's a man called by God in all ramifications.
You will never see Father Owoeye disagreeing with any church leader. Even when he disagrees with what they do, he will always support their work and their ministry. That is how loyal he is to the church.
What project does God have in heaven that he wants Owoeye to come and supervise? Is he building houses in heaven? Is he raising funds? Father Owoeye has work to do on earth. He should have left him to do the work.
So what we have now is just few words to capture a life of Christ General.
Your grace, the same way feelings and gentlemen, I want to welcome you warmly to this ever-making event.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, a recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those that are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord.
Father is the first son of my mom, and I'm the last born. My aunties, my mommy, they like telling us about the past. So they told me about Father, that when they are in Ansegba, it's like maybe that place is Ondo State or so. That Father, that my mom, she's a trader, and my dad is a police officer. My mom went to trade, but one of my aunts used to stay with Father then. So they said people were passing, they were preaching. They now saw Father Boyega. They said, this boy is a great man of God, though. He's a very great man of God that worldwide people will know him.
We are here today in the office of Archbishop Gabriel Leke Abeguri, the Archbishop of Ibadan Archdiocese. Please, could you share with us who Father Ezekiel Ade Owoeye was in your hand under your shepherdry?
Well, Father Ezekiel Owoeye really was already in the diocese before I came. When I was in the Oshogbo Diocese, a bishop of Oshogbo, but at the retirement of Archbishop Job, I was transferred here. So when I came, I saw him the way he was working, and I found that he was a really churchman and committed, who listened to me so well. So, and I tried to fix some people in places. The only title I give to him is that, well, you not only look after University of Ibadan and JDPC, but you look at all the structures in the diocese. So I made him the director of works and development.
I remember vividly, you know, if not for him, perhaps my husband would not have ended heaven, because he has been coming here. Then my husband would tell him, Father, you have to come and take confession from me, you know, if you want me to go to heaven and so forth. Then he say, okay, I will come. But later on, when he was ill, he was in Oluyuru. I was there too. And then we just phoned Oluyuru, Ayelari, and his friend that Rob is in Oluyuru. So he quickly told Father Wey. Father Wey said he was so tired on that day that he went, but that he still went there. Went to around 11. And then when my husband saw, he said, "Ah, Father, at last you are here, okay." So so he said, "Okay." He confessed his sins. And then Father said, "Do you want to have communion?" He said, "Yes." After how many years? Almost 50.
Wow.
Years ago. So he received the Holy Communion and then hugged Father, kissed Father, and was happy. And then in the morning, by 8 o'clock, he's gone.
Wow.
Yeah.
Father Owoeye, I met him during our seminary training. He was about 4 years behind me. Wherever there is noise and people are bubbling with life, that's where they gave him the way bubble. He's there. I was never as close to Father Owoeye in my life as I became close to him when I was assigned in the seminary. I became even closer with him when I became the rector. Because by that time, it is known that there is a priest in this province, in this region, who has been so gifted with building. He never, I always ask him, "Where did you go to school for engineering?" He didn't. It was through experience. It is by learning from the expertise of the professionals he had around him. And he has built this up, and there are evidence everywhere. He was called out from one diocese to the other, one congregation to the other, to build houses, to restructure houses that is failing, to build graveyards for them. And I came to recognize that gift in him when I became rector, because I've seen testimonies all over. And so when I became rector, it was necessary. That is the rector of St. Peter and Paul Major Seminary between 2012 to 2019. It was necessary that our buildings that we inherited that were already becoming dilapidated needed to be refurbished. All I needed to do is to schedule a meeting with Father Owoeye, walk him through what I want to do. He will come back with ideas of what we need to do. He was so cost efficient and effective that he will get you workers who will get the work done on time with the best quality. And that is why Bodija is as beautiful as what it is. In 2012, when I became the rector, I discovered that 1 year afterwards, the NUC will be coming to the seminary, and they had met the former rector, and one of the conditions for us to keep our affiliation was that we needed to have an independent administrative block. There was no plan on ground. I didn't inherit any plan, except a talk. And so, immediately, I knew that 1 year time, NUC will be here. Even though we could not accomplish a big building for that 1 year, we could start something. So, what we have in Bodija today, we'll call Maurice Maguire Administrative Block. I would say, is completely the fruits of his labor. I provided the money, I provided the presents. He gave all the designs that we have given. And you just need to go there and see. Father Owoeye, having built this structure, apart from many rehabilitation of the structure to the seminary he had done for us, we thought, because he was also an alumnus of St. Peter and Paul Major Seminary. When that work was completed in 2018, or 16 thereabout, it was about time that we should dedicate it and we should honor him in what we call our annual reunion, the AGM meeting of the Alumni Association. I told him about it. We prepare our plaque, we prepare our speech, and it was supposed to be, and he promised he was going to be there. But a shy man that he was, too humble the man that he was, he chose that day to go to site outside the Ibadan to go and walk. When it was time, we called him, we were not there. We still did the call out. We honored him. One of his best friends and his classmates had to take the plaque to him. And thereafter, I was angry. I met him. And I told him, Father, but we agreed you were coming. You know what we would say in Yoruba? In other words, that is not important. It's my alma mater. I wasn't so pleased, I must tell you. And I had a discussion with the Archbishop, Gabriel Abegoin. I said, well, look, you are the chairman of seminary, but this man has worked so much, tirelessly. He came in night and day. He came in without asking for money. He must have used the true time and his energy. For all the experts we brought to the field, we gave them something for the work they did. I would like you to approve me to give him some honorarium. Oh, the bishop said, why not? It's a great man. If you are going to get an engineer on site, you know how much you pay. So we decided, and I actually carved out a very good amount of money, wrote a check to him, and wrote the sentiment of all the formators and said to say, appreciate him. I sent it to him in a letter. Lo and behold, I'm saying this for the first time in public. Lo and behold, 1 week or 2 weeks after that, I got a letter back from him with a check attached. He returned it to seminary, claiming, this is my alma mater, this is my church. I will give all I have for the church. So you do not need to pay me. I was so impressed. And from there, I learned from him. A selfless man. Man who gives himself to people, to the church, without asking for material blessing. He was very spiritual.
When my father was sick, he was one of those who also came to his bedside to pray for him. That was way back 1999. And, that was even before I met him. My mom had known him. He was quite close to my family. My daughter, on her birthday, I would tell her, don't tell Father Way that you're sick, because I know he's going to go out of his way to do something. Last year, he called her and said, these are the things I want to do. I want to take things for my class. I also want to buy drinks. And behold, on that day, he just called me and said I should come to the road. And he bought all those things. He gave her, these are the ones you go and share with your friends in class. The wristwatch he's using now, he gave it to her, you know. He just come and say, give this to Patricia, you know. So, of course, he's just that kind of a person. He's concerned about you. I remember when my son had surgery in Oluyoro. I didn't know. But it was much later when we were looking for the case file that we realized that Father had paid for the surgery. I was really shocked. When I went to go and said, did I give anything to you? He doesn't want you to thank him for anything. He doesn't want to be celebrated for anything he does.
How do I capture 26 years of mentorship in few words? Ezekiel was the first priest I ever had close encounter with as a young, as a growing Catholic, a young man. He nurtured me. He gave me my first Holy Communion. He trained me in the seminary. We traveled all over Nigeria. I was his driver, even as a student. Even when I was away on studies, he was about the only priest who visited me and who took care of his own bills, even while he was there with me. And every time he was leaving, I was also sure that something was going to come. Even when I came home for holidays, there was a room prepared for me in this house. But every time I came, he said, that's Anthony's room. That's Anthony's room.
Well, yeah, before Father Owoeye came to Seat of Wisdom, UI, I was already in that parish working with Monsignor Adeibo. So when Father was transferred to the parish, I met with him and I was thinking that, okay, well, maybe that would be the end of my work there. But Father welcomed me very well and told me that he would actually want me to continue working with the students there. And that was something that I found quite encouraging.
Father Owoeye was not just a parish priest or a chaplain at the University of Ibadan, Seat of Wisdom Parish. He was also a father, a mentor, a friend. Father Owoeye was always there for the students of the parish, regardless of how busy he was in other spheres of the diocese. Father Owoeye was personally very kind to me while I was in school, and he graciously extended that kindness to my younger sibling, and for that I'm eternally grateful.
Right after I was born, for my mom is an Anglican, she's from Anglican family. So she got married to my dad. My dad is a Catholic. So few years after I was giving birth to my dad, traveled. So I think during that period of time, my mom met with Father Weyon quite some time. Then Father spoke to her. She brought me into the Catholic Church. That was the first parish she was in, Okiofa. That was the very first Catholic church I also attended as a child, as a baby. Growing up, I attended a Catholic. Father made sure I attended the Catholic primary school. I attended Mary U Convent School. And it was Father because I used to attend a private school, Morningstar. Then Father spoke to my mom that why can't she take me to a Catholic school so it will build me up, my faith in the Catholic way and everything. So I had to change my school to Mary U Convent School. And I started attending there. Before I started my Holy Communion classes, Father told me why haven't I, he asked me why haven't I started my Holy Communion classes. And I told him because I was scared. I didn't really know people in the parish. And Father told me it's not about knowing anyone. It's about the God you are serving. He was just not a priest to me, he was also my dad. I've always known him as my father, my dad since then.
He's a father, he's my mentor, he's my boss, and he has actually done a lot to me. He's my guardian too. I stayed with him for about, 28 years. Because ever since his ordination, we have been together. Permanently, I moved into his place 3 years after his ordination. So that should be like 25 years that I've been staying with him.
Father Weyer pampered me so much. And that's why I'm calling him a father. Not just a reverend father, a father. A father indeed.
It's like a father to me. He always called me Escriva Maria after Mass. He was a good man and was very kind to kids. He always teased them and make them feel happy.
And they should be treasured. And it's a life that must be protected. They must be protected. And they must be brought up properly to fear God, to respect neighbors, to respect those who are older than them, and most importantly, to contribute to the society positively.
All the time Father Weyer has been priest, I have been part of that journey because I became priest 4 years before him. And when he became priest and was ordained in his town in Ikire, I wasn't there physically, but I knew he was assigned to one of the parishes he has adopted as his parish, that is Okiofa. And that's where he started as an assistant priest.
Reverend Father Weyer was posted after ordination at the Holy Cross Catholic Church, Ikire. He came to our midst as the assistant parish priest when Reverend Father Chite was at the helm of affairs. Immediately I heard that Oweye is to be posted here without knowing him before. I took it to myself to go and bring him with my car from Ikire. But on that day, the car gets trouble. I told him the story when he came, that I was to pick you at Ikire. And he asked the question, Papa, do you know me before? I said, I saw the glory of God in your name after the transfer of Father Martin Chite. He took over the helm of affairs. He started humbly and began in earnest to begin what God sent him to do.
He had lived with a lot of missionaries, SMA priests. And they had a lot of influence on him, the way he takes his priestly life and the way he likes grassroots evangelization. He demonstrated that as an assistant priest. You know, he would never refuse any work. And then there's no doubt because of his closeness to people and grassroots desire to bring the faith to the people, he was considered to be the parish priest a few years later. And that is where he stayed more than 12 years.
He transformed Okiofa. Okefa was having about 11 or 12 outstations. And Father Owoeye covered all the outstations. And he built many structures, particularly the Miriam Grotto at Okefa. He transformed the Paris House into modern structure, including the boys' quarters. After some years, he went out to build Divine Mercy Okefa. And Divine Mercy is in Manhattan, one of the outstations of Okefa. That place now is now a parish on its own. Owoeye is a gentleman. I know the Holy Spirit was in him because he found things very easy for him as he was being led by the Holy Spirit. We have an outstation at Ogbodioloba, Queen of Peace. Through his effort, the place was transformed and it's now a parish. He has a farming project, Akinsawe, about how many miles to Ibadan, which he goes regularly to visit, to supervise. And he influenced a lot of things, particularly on the youth. Through his influence, we can count about 8 priests whom he influenced, and about 6 reverend sisters.
I'm sure we are between 15 and 20 priests and religious that through the life of Father Owoeye were influenced or were inspired to embrace the priesthood or the religious life.
Father Owoeye encountered all of us at our prime age.
I finished my secondary school before I received my first Holy Communion because I was one of those people who go to the catechism class that I would go and play football in the stadium. Instead of coming play, go and play hockey in the stadium, instead of going for catechism class. But when God arrested me to go to the seminary, Father Ezekiel was the one who gave me my first Holy Communion so that I would be able to go to the seminary. And that was how my journey started with him. When we vacate from the seminary, all of us seminarians, we report straight to the parish. And from my very first year, I was sharing the same room with him. Once I'm leaving the seminary, I pack into his bedroom. And if by chance I slept off on his bed, he will throw a mattress on the floor. And as a year one student, as a seminarian in first year philosophy, if I slept off on his bed, he will throw a mattress on the floor and he will sleep on the floor. That's the kind of person he is. And all along, he has nurtured me, and nurtured not only me, many others like myself.
It made me to encounter Christ while I was at the stage of making critical decisions in my life. I knew Father Owoeye shortly after I finished my secondary school. I did not have my English language. While my brain was still fresh, he enrolled me back into the secondary school so that I could have my papers. And to God be the glory, I sat for my WAEC, I studied, and God crowned my efforts. After writing our exams, our WAEC examination, Father Owoeye ensured that he took us to various places so that we can be getting a living. Many of us went to the Catholic Hospital, the OLA Catholic Hospital at Oluru. We worked there. Pink nurses, pharmacy attendants, theater workers, and that was how we started. And when the issue of my vocation set in, I told my story to my mom. My mom said she knew nothing about it. The only person I could take you to was Father Owoeye. And my mother sent me to Father Owoeye. I told Father Owoeye my encounter and my desire. Father Owoeye said, "I do not know what to say, but I will deliver you, I will take you to the very right hand." And so, my father, Father Owoeye, took me to the OLA convent, and I met Reverend Sister Lucy Ezedebe, And from there, the journey started.
He saw me in Okeofa, and he picked me among the Masawa. Even though what he said that time is something that I don't think I need to share. He just said, you, why is it that your hair is always untidy? And I, Father, you know, we have gone to school now, children, all that. My hair is always untidy. When we get home, we will not comb again, and that's all. So the encountering of faith, he started by giving me rosary. The very first day I met him, he gave me one rosary. I cherish it so much. So after that, he gave me secret of the rosary, which draw me closer to saying rosaries every time. Then the other part of it, I've been so used to him. After 3 years that I moved in with him, I've been so used to him that when I failed out, like Father Mark used to tell us, when you fail your SSC, don't say you have passed out, say you have failed out. So I failed out my SSC, and at the same time, I was bitter, crying and all that. We have to go to my dad in Lagos. From there, we traveled to Benin Republic. When my dad saw my results, he said, no, you have to do something about yourself. And they were, both of my parents were contemplating on telling me to stay behind, to stay with my uncle in Benin Republic. But my mind was with Father Owoeye. Because of him, I said, no, I cannot stay. If I stayed with that man is the chief priest in Togo now. So probably I would have been worshipping the idols. So it's because of Father Owoeye that I did not go to that place. So he has drawn me back to Christ. He made sure I still eventually further my education. It got to a point I got tired, never relented. There was a time, one of those times that I failed again. Father was very bitter. He didn't know what to do, and he's the type that always feels shy too, somehow. When you are crying, he will almost cry with you. So it was like, where is Jude? Jude is in the chapel. Because I went to the chapel straight, I started communicating with God and trying to cry to God, why me, why me, why me? But eventually, he just calmed down and he made me relax. Then he told me, now, you have to further your education, you have to do this. He sent me to First Seminary, Minor Seminary. When I finished from there, I did not make my exams, my papers again. He sent me again to another Minor Seminary so that I would make my papers. But eventually I made my paper before I finished in that second seminary.
Back then, as my parish priest, and I was still a small child, if you encounter Father, then you want to become a priest. Yes, the way Father celebrates Mass, you know, devotedly, with passion, with conviction. And these were the things that we saw as children, as a child I was then. And I could not but want to be a priest. And so the motivation, the enthusiasm to become a priest began from what we saw, or what I saw, in Very Reverend Father Ezekiel at the Owoeye. Immediately I was ordained as a deacon. My brother priest, Father Henry Molade, brought me as a new deacon to come and greet our father, Father Ezekiel Owoeye. And you know, with that joy, with that enthusiasm, seeing another son, you know, it was a sign of his productivity. And Father sprang up, like, he welcomed me, he greeted me, welcome, welcome. And Father hastily went to the kitchen. It was late in the evening. It was Father that actually prepared the food that I ate that evening. Father, yes, he ran to the kitchen, then back at the old house. He prepared the food. And I could remember that when Father wanted to leave the food from the gas cooker, it burnt his hand.
So God used Father Ezekiel Owoeye to nurture that priesthood in me.
So I'm happy that he has touched so many lives.
So he's a friend of the community. He kept the compound, he kept it open for people in the community to come and fetch water at any time, even at odd hours, at 8 o'clock. And I know the Spirit of God that has spoken in him that made him to excel. I want to, at this point, thank the Almighty God for bringing Father Owoeye to Okeoba to do the transformation he did there. It is something you can see, something you can touch, something you can talk about, and this one lives after him.
That parish today, that's a Cyprian, would never forget Father Owoeye. So Father Owoeye lived long as a parish priest of that place. It was there that he got the appointment to become the JDPC director. And we can see where he has carried that vocation to.
I want to welcome you all to JDPC, and I wish you the best in all your undertakings. You are warmly welcome.
I'm working with him. He's someone that you just need to get to know him and understand his personality. Otherwise, you will not get along with him. You know, he puts up this bravado, this tough look and stance. And if you're not careful, you might have hypertension just knowing that he has arrived in the office. And so, but if you take your time to understand his personality, then you can work with him. Because what he does is leadership from behind. Father Owoeye will not, he might sell an idea to you, but he expects you as a professional to take the lead and do things professionally. Even when he gives you, brings up some suggestions, he doesn't expect you to just say, yes, Father. He expects you to critique it or interrogate it and say, Father, I'm sorry, this cannot happen because of this. Or maybe because it's against the law, this is the consequences. But if you just accept it because your boss has brought an idea, by the time the thing comes down on you, on the organization, he's going to give it to you hard. And that's why in JDPC, professionals are employed. You won't find anybody who is here because of sentiment. You are either a professional in that field. You're not going to find a carpenter doing a tailor's work here. If you're in the agri sector, then you're a professional agri graduate or professional in that field, and so you do it. So that's the kind of person he was.
On behalf of the management of the Justice, Development and Peace Commission of the Catholic Diocese of Ibadan, I'm very pleased this morning to welcome you all warmly to this occasion of the launching of this new project. The importance of food security at this time in the history of our country cannot be overemphasized. But when you talk about food security, we must talk also about nutrition. Many people are down today because they do not have enough food to eat. Many others are not healthy because they are not taking in the right nutrition. Now that we are getting help from them to boost our production, we must also take into consideration the fact that the feed that we produce must be quality and at the same time affordable. Whatever we do and we are not producing for those at the grassroots level, we are not there yet.
And then, when I said he led from the back, you know, he will push us into the eye of the storm and then expect us to survive out there. And initially, we didn't understand what that was all about. We used to think Father has abandoned us. He's not supporting us. But now we, in the course of, you know, working here, we got to understand what that meant. So we could face government officials we could find our way into the governor's office, the speaker, you know, all the state agencies and offices, and have our jobs done. Whatever advocacy we are clamoring for, we're able to push it through because of the way he led us. Even when donor representatives come, representatives of embassies, we just sit at the back. That's if he's there. Otherwise, he sits at the back and he says, these are the field officers, talk to them. They have the information. I don't have. Mine is to supervise. So that was the kind of training we got. You get your training on the job. Though one of the areas that I would say doesn't really go down well with me is not really, sometimes in some aspects, he has a professional in-house there. Yeah. I would still rather go out there and get the consultants, in quotes. Even though the persons in here are qualified consultants on their own. Losing him was a big blow. We are just, the only part where we are able to stand is the fact that the way he led, you know, the legacies he left behind, that is, take responsibility for what has been put in your charge. Don't say because it's not mine. And so it should be destroyed. So facilities have to be kept, maintained, ensure that they are secure, they are safe, nothing is stolen, nothing is broken. And if things are damaged, that they are repaired, you know, on time. So that's the maintenance for him was key.
I'm pleased this morning to welcome you all one day to this stakeholder discourse on effective implementation of community service law and administration of criminal justice law for your state. The Justice Development and Peace Commission of the Cardinal Diocese of Ibadan has contributed and cooperated immensely to the growth and development of the state, especially in the areas of the promotion of good governance and social development. Apart from age-long involvement in prison warfare and legal representations and interventions in prisons, which is key on the mandate that we receive from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, that while I was in prison, you visited me. Over the years, the church felt the need for a new approach beyond maintaining inmates in prison and giving them legal representation. The reason for this is not far-fetched. It appears that those interventions are laudable and tasking. They do not exactly deal with the root cause of the problem of prison congestion and the embarrassing delay in criminal justice system. The DDPC therefore decided to tackle this problem head-on by championing advocacy for reforms in the criminal justice system, with particular campaigns for community service as an alternative sentence to imprisonment for minor offenses, and a review of the criminal procedure law of Oyo State.
He's someone that is concerned about the environment. He wants a conducive environment for everyone to work in. And he was quite compassionate too. He didn't want to just sack people. Even when projects end, we had to develop a system, a financial system, such that even when my project ends, I can still work for some months, depending when a new project is approved.
He threw himself into the work and really tried to help a lot of people. And I recall one incident. I was in Lagos. I was just in Lagos, and then I was walking on the streets very close to our parish, St. Dominic's Yaba. And lo and behold, I saw Father Weah. You know, it was during the election period. It was with some people on foot. And so I stopped, Father, what are you doing here? He said, oh, they came, they are trying to monitor a number of things concerning the election. And I found that very interesting, that he would also give his time to just ensure that things go well, not just with working in the parish, but also things that had to do with justice and peace.
So he was able to put that in place. The structures are quite good. Even if it's not around for a year, DDPC will run effectively as long as we have someone who can sign off for funds and then release the funds. Accounting, you have to give account for every kobo you spend. And that's one other area that, you know, legacy that we'll be holding on to. The fact that the money was there, but it's not money that can be spent anyhow. Each fund is allocated to a project, to an activity. So it's not that this, you are supposed to buy a bag with 1,000 naira, you now divert it and buy a shoe or slippers. No, you can't do that. Because donors, some donors will expect you, if you have leftover, you return the money. So he was very, he would tell you, look, if we have not spent that money, let's return it. I don't want trouble. No. So he was, that's the kind of thing. He was accountable. He said, look, we have an accountant. He said, you are the accountant and the accounting officer. I'm the one giver. I'm responsible for everything here. So I have to give accounts. You cannot tell me this. And, you know, he will query. Even when we raise requisitions for activities, he will still query and say, why do you want to give so much to so-so-so? No, this is too high. But what he's strictly trying to do is to be sure that you know what you're doing. He wants to have justification. If what you're saying, you're confident about it, you're sure about it, you have justification for it, he will support it. Yes, he will. And then he's a funny person. You know, some of the projects, we have a lot of fields. For example, the agri sector. There are lots of projects outside here in some rural communities. So if you are giving your monthly reports and you want to cook up a story, it will just give you the shock of your life. You say, I was at so-so-so place. That thing you erected on so-so place, is it not there? You say, yes, I saw it. It will tell you whether it's working or it's not working. So you'll be like, okay, now. You know you can't just lie because you say, there's no corner of Ibadan or your state or something, I don't know. So even if he tells you, okay, I can't come to your program, maybe in Lanlate, you might just be shocked as you're traveling down, his vehicle will just pass you. Or you get there and you find him at the venue. So assuming you were not prepared, he will just catch you red-handed, you know, in your unpreparedness. So he ensures that integrity is key for him. The another thing he does for us, which sometimes is frustrating. Honestly, when Father Weye tells you, well done, it means you're almost dying. If he says, well done, you have done well. Honestly, by the time you check your state of health, you're almost breaking down. Because for him, if you like, do bring down the heavens. He'll tell you, is it not your work? What have you done? If you achieve one thing this year, he'll tell you, if you repeat it in another report, the next question is that the only thing you can achieve or that you can report? There is no other thing that can be done. So he keeps pushing us to see what are the new things. Then he is ahead of you in terms of information. You know, he said, you put down, read, and stop spending so much time on your phones. Read, go to the library, read newspaper, read, you know, journals, and, you know, listen to news. Because at meetings, you hear him say, okay, government policy on so-so-so says this. So those of you in the human rights sector, so what are you doing about it? You should be working along with happenings or, you know, as issues emerge in society. Think globally and act locally. That's always what he's, you know, reiterating for us. So that's who Father Weye is for us.
The JDPC office, they are putting so much in structure that even that now that it's not there, the work is going on very well. It's as if it's supervising them. And because of the way he has brought them up, they are still very loyal, they are still very committed. They are feeling his absence, but are still working very hard in the JDPC office. And I'm happy that the work is going on because in some places, once somebody goes like that, the place is down or is dead. Even when he was alive, he may not be there for one whole week doing the other works, but the work will be going on because it has been well structured. And that's the beauty of it. That's why our foreign partners, they really love the system, that they trusted him so much that whatever he requested, let him have it.
He's a priest with a big difference, because many priests have come into that ministry of JDPC and they have lost their vocation because of their knack for money and power. You will never see Father Weye dressed exceptionally wonderful. You will never see him buying
vehicles and chains of vehicles. He buys vehicle for duty. Severally, we had an argument about this. Even before he died, he was thinking of changing his vehicle. He was just procrastinating. He was looking for a vehicle that would be used for work. That is how simple it is. I only saw shoes in Father Uweye's leg only when he's going for liturgy.
Of course, even in the priesthood, I could see his detachment from all the material things that he had the opportunity of mobilizing. He can mobilize money from under the water. He had that capacity, and people had a misunderstanding of how he got his money. Some people thought he just goes to JDPC account and takes money. He can't do that. What he does is, as long as the project is meant for the development of the human person, he can beg for money from any source. As long as the source is also legitimate. Individuals, organizations, you know, he travels a lot. And so everywhere he goes, he's talking about projects that he has. So he has so many friends supporting him financially. So people have some people have that misconception that he's getting the money from JDV. So that JDV, you are not giving us money to do this, do that. But your guy is building so that we just smile. It's not JDPC money. If the donor gives you money to erect a two-story building, then you must erect a two-story building. They want to see the costing, the every step of the way. That's the way it is. He was passionate about, you know, construction, developing areas. I remember him mentioning that one of our casual discussions, like, I'm tired of you, there's nothing to do again. He has finished building on every piece of the land there. So he was like, I wish we mentioned the one rural parish. He said he wished they could take him there, that there's work to be done there. That's the kind of it he was. Building for him is a passion. Sometimes in the office, we were joking and we were saying, look, the Society of Building should give him a fellowship, because I think he has met all the requirements in terms of knowledge. He will tell you how many bags of cement you need to complete a 5-story building, how much tipa of sand you need, he will tell you, because, you know, experience. He has become an expert in construction. Yeah, he didn't believe that anything was impossible. He said, look, I don't believe something is impossible. Just put your mind to it. Once you are determined, he believes you can find a way around something.
The legal holder of Justice Development and Peace Commission, Most Reverend Gabriel Eke Abeguri, the Vicar General, the Very Reverend Father Gregory Oyelami, Deans, Episcopal Vicars here present, Very Reverend and Reverend Fathers, Reverend Sisters, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased this evening to welcome you all to this epoch-making event of the official opening of this capacity building center belonging to the Catholic Archdiocese of Ibadan. The importance of the building of capacities for development has become an issue that cannot be compromised under any guise. And over the years, there have been enormous pressure placed on our limited facilities here, because our center has drawn many individuals and groups from within and outside our heart diocese and province who need one kind of training or the other. It is not that there are no facilities that can accommodate trainings and workshops in Ibadan, but most times they are not affordable. Because of this, some of those workshops have to be canceled or be indefinitely postponed as a result of their lack of funds. This is expected to form our local contributions in the execution of our development plan and activities. Many years ago, we embarked on this project and it suffered a huge setback as a result of breach of procedural protocol on our part, which is regrettable. I assume responsibility for that breach. It must, however, be noted that the action was taken the best of intention to move the Archdiocese to a greater height among other JDPCs in Nigeria. It was not intended to hurt anyone, and I remain contrite for that action. I'm sorry, I remain sorry. This center for which we are gathered for his opening today was initiated by our High Bishop, Most Reverend Gabriel Leke Abeguri. On this note, we want to express our sincere appreciation to God the Father Almighty for making it possible for us to come this far. And also to His Grace, our High Bishop and legal order of JDPC, for his keen interest in development work in this diocese, and for his words of encouragement, which we appreciate so much. Your Grace, we are very grateful to you.
One major challenge that we see, and sometimes he has to also talk about, is the fact that he has worked here for so long without an assistant. And that was quite challenging for him. And then he had his health challenges as well. So of course, sometimes we have to take documents to his parish house because probably he's held up somewhere. You know, he has to do some other assignments for in the parish, as well as other pastoral assignments given to him by the local ordinary. So he had that challenge of having to supervise the organization himself, not having someone else to do that for him, at least someone that is officially assigned as a deputy or an assistant. So that made him bring up various deputies, the heads of programs, like became their own supervisors within each the program or the unit. So that's what he did.
Father Owoeye was my parish priest of Our Lady Seat of Wisdom from the year 2007 till it's called to glory.
When Father Owoeye came, that was the first time that we were having a parish priest who was not a member of faculty in the university. So, of course, with Father Muyoth and then Father Adegbu and before them Father Foley, you know, all of them were professors in the university. So when he came, he had to settle in initially. So it was a bit rough because he came in his full character and he would tell people exactly what to do. And there were some people whom we considered then infallible members of the parish. And so he would just insist on certain things, you know, trying to do things well. And so he met with a bit of opposition.
So later, Father started working and they saw his work. The first project Father did was the toilet, the parish toilet. We're constructing, we had a committee handling the parish toilet then. But he didn't like what structures we put there. Father is a quality person, particularly when it comes to construction. So he stopped the committee and took over the toilet. When he completed the toilet, he appointed somebody to be maintaining the toilet. I tell you, you can eat in the toilet. You can eat your food in the toilet. To tell you the extent of neatness in the toilet. Was water, everything. Project. Next was the one and a half bedroom my father's house.
You know, we had this traditional chairs there from, you know, those initial sets of chairs with poofs and, you know, rugged things, but they were there in that place and all the priests that had been there had used them. So he came and, you know, he more or less like changed the entire look of the interior.
I tell people the only thing Father you don't change in that house is the roof and the blocks, the wall, everything Father changed. So when parish leaders saw this one,
We walked into that parish house and I just saw the transformation. I said, wow, okay, this priest has come. He means business. Yeah, he means business, certainly.
So he started the church after doing this house. From the house, he got the parish office. We never had a parish office. I don't know how the previous priests were operating. He got the parish office, got somebody appointed as secretary. Then, meanwhile, the hall, the John Paul Hall was just pillars carrying, going to two floors. That's all. Maybe one side of the block piece. He did that one. He started that one. The church itself, the pews were too old for Father's. He said, ah, we have professors here, we have everybody, we have businessmen here. You can't look at the pew you are sitting on. He came with, and he said, where he was coming from, or where he came from, people bought pews. By the time you know it, family started buying pew. Some bought three, some bought four, some bought two. And quality pews. The ones we had, we gave them out to younger parishioners who were just up and coming parishioners, I call them. Then the painting in the church changed everything. He got friends, father had friends. He got people, early people, who somebody bought our ACs. When people saw what he was doing, now people were also ready to give.
So that's how it started. And you know that at that time is he was pretty young and all of that, but he stamped his authority, and then eventually he gained the confidence of members of the parish.
There used to be an Iroko tree, big forest. Our parish was a forest. It used to be a forest.
I mean, you had pebbles and you had sand and trees and everything, and it was just scattered bush.
When we removed the Iroko tree, he led to the establishment of the UI sawmill. Father changed the face of the university.
I remember one of our chancellors that time, Professor Adewole, said, ah, can you see what we have done? That's UI for you. I just laughed and said, ah, this is the Catholic community. It is not a UI project. But then he tried to take the glory because it is within the university community. And even at that time, before Father Woye was able to erect all these structures, the community itself were trying to or not allow him do what he wanted to do.
We had an encounter. I was dean there when I became president of the Lady Council. We were doing the retention block, retaining work for the hall. And our people in UI, the maintenance people, they dug on the foundation of the retaining wall. And Father called me on Saturday morning, said, Prof, I'm going to do this thing. I said, go ahead. You have my back. Because he said, the retaining wall could fall. And when it falls, it could cause accidents on members of our church, people who don't want to relate to us in the church, or anybody. It could minimum affect our church, but it will be said that retaining wall in Nepal, in the analysis of wisdom, fell and kill Suzu or damage Suzu. We didn't want that. He said he didn't want that. And so we did that one. Then about 2 meters to complete it, they called me. The DBC admin, then called that the DBC was turned around. The DBC admin called that we stopped putting, they want to put pipe water from Aminawe to Queens Hall. When they should have gone straight, it's a direct into Queens Hall, but they just took a wrong route and they passing through our church. In fact, the interlocking function that Father did for the floor, those pieces were bushes, were trees planted there. Now, one day the maintenance came and just removed them, removing them without even cause that somebody is in the parish. If that we are going to do that anything in the parish, people have contacted the priest. There's a priest here. They didn't do that one. They did, but Father called me and said, Father, let me talk to them. What they did there, they can't do that one in the mosque. They can't do it anywhere. They can't do even the chapel of the revolution. Yeah. When they were doing the road, I think Father was there. That's when the building was, the UI road. When they were doing the road, the signboard, we used to have a signboard to the church. They removed it. Their bulldozer cracked it. They just was, it's as if we were tempted on looking at how we do. The pothole, even their bulldozer cut one part of it. The building that is still standing, they are just tempting us. But thank God we got over this. The building there, the new building that is under construction, you know, that's where our students used to read, and there was a security problem. In fact, the former house, the father's house there, 2 times they attempt to steal, and Father still allowed the students to reach till late. Father, it's a prof, where do you want them to go? There's no light in the house there. And here we can generate electricity for them. He didn't like the quality our students were reading. And that's why I put up that structure. For the university, we had our issues there too. I can tell you what pained me one day. The borehole structure, The machine that father wanted to convert to industrial bowl that can supply water around the day. But the machine that was coming to do that one day was stopped at the university gate for 2 days. And you know you have to pay for each day the machine stays there. 2 days before we got permission for it to come in.
At the time the borehole was made, there was no water on campus. It was like we were suffering. And God brought him and he made borehole. And every member of this community, either you are a Christian or a Muslim or anything, even people from outside, will also come to the campus, to the Catholic compound, to fetch water.
I mean, forever people are so grateful for opening up the water system and things like that, making sure that people can come. I mean, people come here 24 hours to fetch water, as in you can drive in here, and I've done it before. I mean, driving coming late from the office, you know, at 1 a.m. and I just say, okay, let me get some water. And you just drive in and you get your water and you go, and you know, life was just, you know, like it is, like Seed of Wisdom was a little heaven, as it were, here.
That was how he was able to assist the university community,
yeah,
to have access to clean water at that time. And I remember that when Professor Ayelari became the deputy vice chancellor administration, I remember it was Father Oye that advised him that you have to talk to your community. Maybe you people should make borehole in some strategic places so that if you can't get water, then what will happen in the campus? And those things came into being because of his love for our university community. God blessed him with the strength to develop our campus and to also touch lives. It is not just the lives within the Catholic community,
yeah,
within the whole campus.
Many of the women would say, for example, that he broke the class barrier amongst the women. So he just came and, you know, initially it was during this time that we first had the president of the Catholic women who wasn't a university professor or university person at that time. Yeah, so he broke those barriers and he made it clear that everybody was on the same level. And
I was not born a Catholic. I was a Muslim. But I later became a Catholic. My focus was to look at Christ on the cross and be able to understand and get the faith right. And I didn't want any distraction. And it was not that somebody invited me. It was Christ himself that directed me to the Catholic Church. I remember one weekday mass, Father Oye waited outside before the mass and just came, please, I want to see you after mass. I was surprised. After mass, we met and he told me he wanted to involve me in the activity of the church. That was how I became so active in the activity of the church. It is not just the church activities alone. My own personal life, he was also interested. There was a time I had a problem with my promotion, not coming on time. And I was so sad. He gave me all the encouragement, told me, continue to pray, God will do it at his time. And I thank God that my promotion came to reality before God called him to glory.
There was no way that you wouldn't have one or two things, you know, that you didn't agree with him about, but he was a child of the church in excess. I mean, everything he did, he had, you know, an ecclesiastical backing for whatever he did, and he was constantly trying to push the frontiers of the church, and you know, that's basically it. So eventually people got used to his character and they will begin to enjoy his homilies, how he will tell you that if you haven't used a piece of clothing for a month, then you're a thief because you're keeping the property of somebody else, you know, and then that strikes you.
It changed our life in this parish. Our giving. Collections in those days used to be very terrible. When it is offering time, what I would tell you is offering time, blessing time. It is in giving that you receive. That in turn into parishioners.
and things like that. And then he pushed so many things about parish registration and all of that stuff. And some of us were a bit resistant about that and saying, why must I carry a card about saying I'm from this parish and things like that? But, you know, he simply ignored those who did not want to participate and took on those who wanted to participate and didn't make a fuss out of it, you know, and just moved on, you know.
Here is the chapel in the rectory. This is one of Father's works. Father was a man of prayer. His breviary is still here. The different volumes of the breviary. The other volume is in his room. These are his prayer books. And with the Holy Bible, this place was Father's seat. Yeah, this is the front view of Oscar Welsh Rectory, Father's house. It was built by Reverend Father Ezekiel at the OWOEYE. This was where Father was staying before he moved into the new Father's house, the old Reverend Father's house. It was not like the Father still renovated it to what we have now. Before us is the new Parish Center. The initiative came about when Father saw our students were struggling with studying out there under rain, under sun. And Father told himself it will not continue like that. He had to do something. And so Father began this project. Now we are moving to the chapel. This is Seat of Wisdom Catholic Chapel, University of Ibadan. This structure was not like this. Father renovated it. The sanctuary, the altar, giving it a more beautiful paint. The pews were all changed, bringing everything to modern standard. Here, Father planned to also erect Chapel of Perpetual Adoration. Also, he planned to put a big statue of Divine Mercy here, if possible the biggest in the archdiocese. He wished that this place becomes the center of mercy for people in the archdiocese of Ibadan. There are other works that Father did, like making source of water to be available for people. This water is now a source of life to many in this community. Almost everybody in UI comes there to fetch water. This is Pope John Paul II. Father, when he discovered that priests and religious we're always stranded whenever they come for studies. Father built this to accommodate people, especially priests and religious, who are on studies. And as you can see, apart from the hall for celebrations, there are rooms, conference rooms, offices that accommodate people for various activities. It's a big hall, and it's also a source of income to the parish. The statue of Saint Pope John Paul II. And we should not forget in the haste that Pope John Paul II once visited this university. So, out of Father's initiative, being a man of history and a churchman, I want to believe that's also facilitated what made Father to build this hall, you know, in honor of Pope John Paul II. And this is the statue. We're approaching the parish grotto. This is the grotto. This was built by Very Father Ezekiel Adewoye. And this is the gate. Father planned to put a dwarf gate here.
Father is God sent to this parish
to this university, and he has accomplished all God has for him. We didn't mention polytechnic facilities again. The church there can swallow our church here.
Actually, the polytechnic was under the Dominicans when I came. The Dominican priest who is at Shango, at St. Christopher. I found that only one person there, the work was too much for Father Adeyemoye there, Abiodun. And I asked Father Adeyemoye, can I make Sitaba the Great of the Poly in my center to UI? And they said, why not? If I give him, I'll do it. And I said, you ought to build it up. He said, no, we shall build it. So then I went back to Father Adeyemoye, the police said, well, if I take this center away from you, how do you feel? He said, ah, please take it, because it's too much for me. So then I wrote a letter to him to say that Father Adeyemoye is appointed, and I'm taking that away from him. And he started slowly. It was a shed. Poly chaplaincy was just a shed, in truth, with benches and all that. So much that the children didn't like it at all, because the mosque and the other church beside them, they were well built up. So that one was just a shed, the bush. So, but the glory of God, within a short time, he built up that church, even with a rectory there, built a rectory there. And the arena was also cleared. Every part of the land was cleared. So much that I loved it so much. And I started building many, and the church was completed. And I was visiting there. First thing he did was, he sank a borehole there. And people come there now to fetch water, whether you are Catholic or no Catholic.
Father really suffered. Each time I remember all the sufferings he has gone through, I almost shed tears myself.
I didn't say mass during the week. You know, I just took it like, okay, maybe he traveled or something, but he was ill. And he didn't mention anything about his own illness. And we were there talking about hours, and he would just talk along with you and, you know, pray for you. And then you leave and you didn't know that anything was happening.
The same father started with wound on his leg, that he could not move out. For about 6 months, he could not come out of his room. And the most painful aspect of it, he went for my dad's burial at Nukeofa. And that was the last ceremony he went for before he was locked up for 6 months with the wound. So after which, we started treating the wound and all that, and eventually he was able to come down and he started mass. After that, he built his house. He could not move in. And I looked at the house. I said, Father, you built this house. Move into this house. This house is ready. He said, no, that he cannot go up because of his leg. So he couldn't go up until around December, December of the same year, before he now, virtually, someone called to open the house, and they said they are moving in. They moved in. The leg has gone a bit, not totally. Another suffering came again. He was having heart issue. So all those pains really goes deep into my heart, as if I'm the one going through the pains. After the heart issue, pile came up, and pile is not what can be said everywhere. It's in private parts. You can't tell anybody except those that are close to you that I have pile. And it was taking all sorts of leaves recommended by some people. Okay, this leaf is good, this is good, this is, and it was taking all those ones, and eventually the pile took a longer time before it eventually left. After that, again, another pain that came to my heart. It went through a lot of pains and all that, and those pains are really touching me. He was telling himself that COVID is never his portion, and he would never want COVID to even move close to him, because he does not know if COVID should come to him, he might not survive it.
It was really after he was hospitalized that I began to hear a lot of stories about, of course I knew that he had a problem on the leg, but he didn't present it as a wound that never healed. He just said, you know, it's just, and that's just because you asked him, and you know, you just say that don't worry about the leg, and things like that, you know. So someone who gave everything but took nothing. He told us that he had spent so much time here that he was doing overtime. You know, he would say that in the homily and so on and so, when he had stepped on some toes, and he was, don't worry, I'm doing overtime, I'll soon leave, you know, and all that stuff.
He had been telling me more than 1 month, I want to go. Everybody thought he was going abroad to go and rest. So I want to run away. He told me many times. I said, okay, if they are bothering you, madam, come to Ujebo. They said, no, Ujebo. They said, if I'm in Ujebo, they will just call me. Said I would not be. I said, I want to just go away so that I have my peace, I can have my tranquility.
And you know, those revelations about him knowing, you know, that it was about time, whilst not actually wishing to leave, but everything is adding up more or less, like he just knew that he needed to do these things and set the pace, you know.
I personally think Father Ezekiel knew something was going to happen. The day we're doing the funeral of Father Macarius, I was with him and Bishop Oletoyinbo preparing for mass. And he said, who is next? Them. And I that was supposed to be a rhetorical question. And immediately he answered, maybe I am the one. And just like Peter chastised Jesus, I turned to him and said, listen, you started your nonsense talk, this man. Fathers don't bury their children. You know, I was referring to the elders, and we laughed about it and we left.
The very grave he told me the third person is going to be. I knew it was the third person. On the day we go on the 17th or 15th of August, when we buried those two priests. I was standing by him. If you look at the video, you will see me together. And it was my first time of seeing a vault of three persons. And it was plain to me that even though this grave was not done very well, it was not deep enough, it should be wider than that. He said, but it's made for three persons. So Anthony went first, Macarius went to third. He said, you still have a place for the third person. He was the one who gave me that lecture. Neither did I know. Did he know that he was going to be the third person? While I was there that day, I said, ma'am, I said, God. So my friend who explained this grief to me is the third person. Yeah. There's a mystery about life, and there's a lesson that we must not waste time. Owoeye does not waste time. He did not move near the grave. He pointed to it. In fact, he actually instructed people from my side what to do. But on that day, nobody was giving instruction again because he was occupying that position. Each one of us, you know, God has ingrained into us, God has planted into us a mystery of how we came and a mystery of how we're going to pass on. It will be good for us to recognize that and follow it through.
And when he was in the hospital and he was in bed, he said, oh, yesterday, when I went to visit him, he said, oh, yesterday I was saying mass with I was in Ireland, I was saying mass with the SMAs. And I asked him, which of the SMAs were you saying mass with? And he was mentioning those the late SMAs who worked in our archdiocese. And I said, all right, you are not in Ireland in any case, you are here in Ibadan. So forget about the SMAs. And a few days later, he said to someone, he said, leave the road. My friends are at the door. They are welcoming me. And to make matters very, very distinct for me, I gave him communion in the morning on Wednesday. I anointed him that day. And in the evening, I went back there. And when I finished in the evening, I came to his room. I was looking for a book, you know, to prepare my lectures in the seminary. I went to his shelf. I looked at it. I didn't get any. The door of his room was locked, was closed. So I opened the door and I saw somebody move in the room. I went in there, put on the light, and I said, who is there?
There was no answer. But I felt this cold I've never felt all my life. And that was the first time and the only time I was genuinely scared something was going to happen to Garrison Commander. And I just couldn't share with anyone.
And then early in the morning, around 5:30, Peter called me. That the doctor called me that father has passed. Father passed on is a liar.
It's more or less he died in my hand. If we had been allowed to stay there over the night, probably I would have been there when he was dying. But because we are not allowed, I saw him last. Among everybody that is close to him, I was the last person that saw him Thursday night before I left the hospital. Eventually he passed on Friday morning.
So when I got the news, that's the first time in my life I'll cry so hard. My mom looked at me and she was like, when she saw my reaction, she knew, no, this is different, you know. I was on the ground, I was wailing.
Yeah, to quantify my my sorrow is unquantifiable. I do my crying in the rain.
Since father died, things have been so different. Life has been so different without him. I miss him every day, every single day, especially when I didn't even get the chance to see him before he died. I miss him so much, and life has not been the same without him.
The morning they told me Owoeye had gone, I was crying and I was singing a song in Yoruba, and I said, "Awon meji yo wa lona oko, awon meji yo wa lona odo. Bi won tin lo won ma wi pe kini wo se lola emi yo gbin isu, kini wo se lola emi yo gbin oka. Sugbon logan agbo gan ki lo sele olugba lati mu kan ko mu ekeji ijoba orun ku dede araye yi pada oni dajo aye nbo ti yo bere lowo re ti yo bere lowo mi bawo lo se lo igbe si aye re. You know what that song means? Is just what is narrated in the Bible, that at the end of time, when the rapture will come, that is what the song is. That two people will be going to farm, two people will be going to the river, one will be picked, the other left. And I told myself that morning, because people were calling us 5 and 6, now 5 have been taken, 6 is left. And he said, later I got that the bearer was that day. Now, what pain me about father, will he die? What pain me most, father's body couldn't be taken to the church. Father died, he couldn't be buried, and his body couldn't enter church. That he worked all his life for is a very painful thing to me. But thank God, he was allowed to be buried at Okiare Cemetery.
For the way his end reflected the personality he was. He came quietly, he influenced people quietly, and he disappeared quietly to the greater beyond. And that is why there was no euphoria or big celebration even at his death.
My dream for Father Owoeye was not fulfilled. I actually want Father should grow old. I want to see Father Owoeye when I have, let me use the word that, as people used to say, when I have arrived. I want to ask Father Owoeye, Father, what do you want? Father, I want to single-handedly build a building that you love to build yourself. If it's a church, I want to single-handedly build it. But my dream never came true.
Is that really, it really affected me. Because after After my 60th birthday, I felt sick. I was really very sick after July 29th, after my birthday. So I couldn't come for morning mass regularly. I came sometime, and at the end of the day, I decided to leave the campus and went to my brother's house to stay with him and his wife and his family. So when I was there, Father Oweye called me. Ah, Prof, what happened? Ah, I've not been seeing you around. You've not been coming for daily mass. Ah, I said, Father, I have been sick, but I'm better. I'm staying with my brother. I'm trying to rest. I said, okay, take your time. Hope you'll come back on time. And that was around September. So one evening, my sister-in-law had some visitors, and my phone now rang. And I brought say, ah, it's Father, where are you? And I picked the phone, ah, Father. And I answered, ah, Father said, ah, ah, are you not going to come back to the campus? I said, ah, Father, I will soon come. That was the evening I made up my mind, and I told my sister-in-law and the husband and my brother that I have to go back to UI. Father has been calling me, and I thank God I came back. And so fortunately, when I came back, I came to make a flower decoration for Sunday. So I met Father. Ah, Prof, you are back. Thank God you are better. Ah, how are you too? He said, ah, it is this my leg. I said, God will heal you. We just spoke briefly. And that was the last time I spoke with Father. And the day that was the last day I saw him. That I cannot forget. That was what had made me so sad.
Yes, Father Oweye was quite appreciative of the work I was doing with the students there. And of course, there was also Father Kenny, who was also there at that time and was working. And so he was very appreciative of what the Dominicans were doing. We would go sometimes in the evening on Saturdays to hear confessions. So we had a very good relationship with Father Oweye. He was very cordial, and he was really indeed glad that we were coming to UI. And it was a very cordial, wonderful relationship.
Once in a private conversation with me, he was talking about, you know, we just needed to keep struggling. The world was not, was very hostile to Christianity and Christian virtues. But we just needed to keep at it and keep at it. You know, he kept on saying that. You know, so he tried to encourage the spirituality. That's in terms of the spirituality. He had a lot of respect for the fathers of the church and those who had come earlier. It was through him that I knew the first two priests. He named the extension of the parish office where the Assam parish priest is after the first two priests that laid their foot on Ibadan. He had a sense of history and, you know, respect for those who came before him and would always hold them in high regard, and he named things after, you know, after them, and, you know, wanted to immortalize the fathers of the church and would tell you exactly how they contributed and things like that, you know.
Orsino's recommendation was to name some of our new structures after our missionaries to immortalize their memories here where they served so well. The church is a continuum. We are not politicians who destroy the legacy of their predecessors. We want to use this opportunity again to pay glowing tributes to the fathers of African missions, especially that of the Irish province. Ably represented here by our two Vicar General Emeritus, the Very Reverend Father Finchin and the Very Reverend Father John O'Hare, SMA. We are grateful for laying successfully the foundation of the church in Ibadan High Diocese. We cannot forget what you have done for us and the legacy you have left behind, and your counterparts, the sisters of the Our Lady of Apostles. We remain eternally grateful to you all who have worked hard in this High Diocese.
And I was really, really pleasantly surprised when he showed up at my father's funeral. I wasn't expecting him to come because I know that period he wasn't really feeling very well. So I wasn't expecting him. I wouldn't have been upset that if he hadn't come. But To my greatest surprise, he was right there in my hometown on that day. And I know that it took him a lot to do that. And so that's, again, one thing that I also learned from him, that if you're working with people, you have to also be part of the things that happen in their life. Well, he was really very kind and very good to me. One thing that I remember very well is my 40th birthday, he decided to throw a surprise party for me. I wasn't expecting that. He just told me he would like me to come over to the parish one Sunday evening. And when I got there, it was a party for me with a lot of people that he had invited. And I was very happy that he did that because, it was just something I wasn't expecting. And when I remember that, I feel happy that he considered me someone close enough to him, a friend that he could do that for.
This service is this way because of him. Actually, this house was no house, no roof, everything. The floor was as black as this chair. He did this way, brought some people to use machine and or something to wipe it and all that. It was as black as this. The way the office is now, even my office and other offices, he did it. I was using the parish office when I came. When he finished with this, that's how I packed him. So the furniture, everything is in this house is the one. The furniture, everything. The floor, everything. The roof, everything. He was the one. I used to worry how he managed to put up structures. But he would tell me not to worry. The Lord will do it. The Lord will do it. He's somebody of deep faith. Somebody of very deep faith. So he did everything in faith, and it worked for him that whatever I wanted to do is done. There are things we plan to do and can be carried out. Well, I feel bad. I feel bad. But we are in the Church of Christ. Christ will raise other people up to continue his work. Amen. That's what I can say. Yeah. Amen.
What I take from him, what I've really learned that I apply or wish to apply is the fact that this mindset that anything is possible. Don't just be discouraged because of one or two challenges on your way. Always find a way around everything. Every issue, every challenge, every problem has a solution. And then generosity. I've learned to really give without counting the cost. And he's detached from the material things, from money, from the cars, from the houses. He's quite very detached. So you see that detachment, and I'm struggling with that virtue. He has given out cars here. You know, people donate cars and say, oh, maybe for his use or something, maybe he has a Paris or something. He looks at his environment, he knows he doesn't need it. He gives out the vehicle to another, maybe organization or individual, and says, use it for your project.
He taught this family to be praying together. He taught this family to be having regular meetings, which we imbibe.
One thing for me that, you know, it just comes out clear with Father Ezekiel Owoeye, the fact that, you know, he just, once he sees what needs to be done, he doesn't waste time getting into it. And that's one thing I just learned working with him, the way he transformed a lot of things in the parish structurally, but also the way people were, the things were done in the parish. Of course, I was there before he came, and I could see that transformation, the number of positive transformations that he brought into the parish. And so that's the one clear lesson that I learned from him, that when you see what needs to be done, don't waste time, don't dilly-dally, just get into it. But then again, his relationship with the students, very interesting. Some of the students, I had to tell them that, you see, you think for the way it's a very harsh, difficult person. No, he has a very kind heart. But then because he knows that if he opens up too much, the student might begin to take advantage of that. So sometimes he would present this very difficult demeanor, you know, you can't really come. And then the students sometimes found that discouraging, but I always tell them, no, that's not the way he is. If you push, he will, of course, open up to you. And then he wants you to be responsible. And so I learned that from him that, yes, you talk with the students, but then you have to also get them to be responsible, get them to take charge of a number of things.
The teaching I've learned from Father is you have to be charitable. You have to take care of, see people, take care of them, if possible, more than yourself. Because that is what he does most. Several times he showed me his alert in the office. Dude, I don't have money and I need to pay some people's school fee. Dude, some people does not have food to eat, particularly during COVID. Some people does not have food to eat. What do? I need to share this money I have in my account. And he will write out a list and be sending money from his account to people. Whichever money he has spent for the parish that he wants to collect back, I say, I need my money. Jude, pay me. I said, Father, I'm not owing you. The parish is owing me. I said, Father, parish, I'm not owing you. You just tell me to pay what parish is owing you. You sign the check, I'll go and bring the money for you. Eventually, we'll find a way. Okay, bring the YC, let's write it. When we write it, we'll say, okay, give me my money from this YC. That money you collect, we will send it to people to feed, to pay their school fees. So I've learned that art of charity from Father Owoeye, and I would like to continue to be charitable in my own capacity.
You know, one of the thoughts that came to my mind when Father died was that, wow, that a lot of people have practically been rendered motherless and fatherless, because Father supported and saw a lot of people through school and maybe some other things, empowered people. He was a man of the people. He was not one that you come to with genuine needs and he would turn his back on, even if he could not do anything at the moment. Or sometimes he wouldn't tell you of what he does. It doesn't mean that he has forgotten. He would do something about it.
Your greatness, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you warmly to this epoch-making event of the flag off of the distribution of relief materials to indigent households in Ibadan, Oyo State, Southwest Nigeria. This type of intervention is our core mandate here at JDBC Ibadan, and we have been living up to it at all times. We all know that this is a very crucial time in the history of Mother Planet Earth, when the whole world has been brought to our knees. The Catholics have been a prominent actor in addressing this issue, though with little visibility. The Church as a whole has donated 255 and facilities, hospitals, and clinics to the federal government to be used as adoration centers for affected persons. This one we gather for this afternoon is yet another demonstration of the service of the Church to humanity. Today, we are going to give food to 100 households. Items that we lack for some time. This is when we need God of us. This is when we need God.
He was faithful to his priesthood. He was, we find sometimes, too rigorous with his principles. You know, when some of us would think, you know, you can calm down here. No, Owoeye believes that, no, this is the only way. We have to give example. We have to lead the church aright. He never misses his word. These are values that we miss out of him. We need priests who stand up with complete loyalty with the church, who talk about values that many people want to trivialize today. And so, the priest of Archdiocese of Ibadan, we miss him. I remember my first discussion with the Archbishop when it happened. He said, where do I begin from? I've lost a big pillar of life and ministry in Ibadan Diocese, and that is it. That's the way I felt. Father, where you came, lived and touched my life with excellence, with dedication, with loyalty to the church. God grant me the grace to go ahead in my life to touch many other people too in that same light.
Another thing is trustworthiness. He's trustworthy. He was a trustworthy man. Otherwise, who would not be supporting the way they were supporting? Wasn't trustworthy. He knew that he was a worker for Christ, and that's why he didn't want to falter in any way he was working. He wanted to do it as much as possible, that he put in the best. So if other people emulate that, the priest religious and lay faithful, to be committed to put people first before any other thing, and to be truthful, to be accountable, to be prayerful, to love the house of God, to love the Church of Christ, and work for her, I think they will be doing a lot of good.
He was a prayerful man. Indeed, a prayerful man. And that's one thing I picked up from him.
He taught me how to pray. He told me in every situation I should always put God first.
His life was just to work assiduously and to pray fervently. He prayed till he drew his last breath.
He was a man of prayer, because sometimes when he called me at night, he would say, Father, where are you? I say, are you in the parlor? I say, yes, I'm in the parlor, you know, with my children or something. What you say? Go inside your room. That is when he will want to share something very secretive with me. Then after about 30 minutes, he will say, I know you don't pray, but I pray. So it's time for prayer. So I'm going to say my prayer. I know you don't pray. So good night.
I come here regularly while I was a rector, even as bishop. He will not miss his prayer time. I call him my spiritual friend. We had a lot of spiritual discussion, and especially around my appointment as Bishop of Jebode and my fears and my anxiety. It calmed me down. We were only talking about, you know, giving our best to God, and that prayerfully we will win all the battles. He has been a pillar.
I'm never sad in the presence of OWOEYE. When I'm with him, either in my house or in the church, I'm always happy. The only sadness I encounter is that he didn't bid farewell to me. But I know that even Jesus Christ died at the age of 33 after finishing all his work. The departure of Reverend OWOEYE is not to make us sad. He has finished all the Lord has told him to come and do. And I know by the grace of God, he's now raised at the bosom of the Almighty Father.